Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to the sixth session of the series on invisible hurdles, injustice in academia. Today's session, we are going to discuss about ableism in academia. Ableism is discrimination in favor of the able-bodied people. So we are going to discuss about the indiscrimination that is faced by people with disabilities. In today's session, we have four panelists with us. Let me introduce you to them. We have Dr. Vikas Gupta. Dr. Vikas Gupta teaches in the Department of History, University of Delhi. He is advisory editorial board member of Contemporary Education Dialogue, published by SAGE. Dr. Gupta is also associated with many organizations like the All India Forum for Right to Education. Dr. Gupta is a member of the Board of Trustees of Kishore Bharati, which has been a pioneering organization in the field of learner-centric and socially contextualized transformative learning process and environment conservation. Dr. Gupta is an executive member of Indian Social Science Academy. He's also the Joint Secretary of Sambhavana, an organization working for the protection of the rights of persons with disabilities. We have next with us Dr. Mrityunjay Kumar Verma, who has done a 5-year integrated MSc from Center for Excellence in Basic Sciences, Mumbai. After that, he has done a PhD in string theory from Harish Chandra Research Institute. And since then, he is a postdoctoral fellow in INFN, Naples, Italy. We also have with us Sonam Paradkar. Sonam has done an MA in Counseling Psychology from Mumbai University and an MA in Clinical Psychology from BAMU. Currently, she is a senior hub counselor with Podar Education Group, an expert on diagnosing and addressing cognitive impairments in school-going kids. We also have with us Dr. Swagata Sarkar, who is a mathematician specializing in algebraic topology. She has done her PhD from Institute of Mathematical Sciences, Chennai, and is at present an assistant professor at the Center for Excellence in Basic Sciences, Mumbai. So with that introduction, let me all tell you that the structure of today's discussion will be the panelists will present their views on the topic for around 10 to 15 minutes each. And then we will open the discussion for questions from the audience. Please feel free to post your questions in the Zoom chat box. And for those who have joined us through Facebook, please post your questions in the comments section. They'll be relayed to the panelists. So before we begin, we begin asking the panelists their view on the topic, I would very quickly like to give my view on this topic. So for me, the experience with disability or seeing disability started as at a very young age because of my upbringing, or I grew up with a sibling who was a patient of severe autism. Along with him, I also saw many other children with special needs. I have interacted with their parents and teachers, and I'm still doing so. What I realize is that these parents or teachers have a lot to struggle for. Like, they have to struggle for the equality or justice of their child or their student in the society, in a society which stigmatizes any kind of disability till date. I have met people who try to not only give a lot of sympathy and advice, but they also tend to justify the disability in a particular child. Like, I have heard people say that this child is disabled because his or her parents have committed some sin in their past life, or because the child was a great person in his past life and therefore now he is making people do things for him or her. That is totally absurd. And what happens is that, unfortunately, people start buying these stories. They fall into the trap of these narratives. And because of this, they not only lose the struggle, but they also fail to educate the society on how to be inclusive towards disabled students or how to accept them as a part of the society. like I have seen students or children who had very severe disabilities and could not make it to the regular schools, but could at least make it to some special schools. But I also know children who couldn't make it to any kind of school. As the series is called Invisible Hurdles, I would not hesitate to say that in case of disability, the hurdles are very, very clear. How we make them visible to the society is still remains a challenge. Because I am speaking about schools and regular schools, I would like to share something about schools and curricula. So I'm going to share the link to... I want to share some part of a book. The book is called It's Debatable, and it is written by Sami Khan and Dana Zarkar, both of whom are science educators. And the book is about introducing socio-scientific issues in the school sciences. Among the other things that I liked about the book, this was one that they have at the end of each module provided how to accommodate students with different disabilities into that module. So they have given a list of these things and what can be done so that students with diverse needs can also be a part of a learning module. When I saw this, I really liked it a lot, and I thought, why aren't our school science curricula designed in this way? I agree that a lot is happening to make science education or to make education inclusive, but we are really not doing anything as nice as this. And if that can be done, we have the expertise, we have the resources. If we see our curricula getting transformed in this way, then I think that will be a huge step in the direction of inclusive education. With that, I would like to start the discussion with the panelists. We would like to start the discussion with Dr. Vikas Gupta. Dr. Gupta, can you please share your views on this topic?
Thank you, Rohini. I hope I'm audible.
Yes.
So my intervention would, of course, be partly an attempt to understand certain concepts through scholarship and the available data, but it'll also be partly, biographical. Before I start, at the outset, I would like to make, I would like to state two things. First, I remember when almost a decade ago, in some context, I had to file a litigation against the insurance corporations, and the verdict came positive, but the entire process was very, very frustrating, and the government agencies were arguing as if they were bargaining something. So, but at the end of it, when the verdict came, Professor Bakshi, Upendra Bakshi, was writing, he wrote in fact a statement congratulating the verdict, and there he made a statement, and which he repeated when we were sitting over a cup of tea, that it is of course difficult to fight discrimination, but it is all the more difficult to fight prejudice. So that's one part of the thing that we must understand, because the whole question of ability and disability is about discrimination as well as prejudice. And the second thing that I want to say is, building upon what Rohini in his introductory remarks has almost initiated, is this idea that, how much is being done, And so I want to make that as the starting point. And I want to start this with education itself. And what do we know? In today's India, 21st century, where we have been making all claims of global power, etc., we are not able to educate or provide complete formal schooling to more than 15-16% of the relevant age group. And within that, the share of education for persons with disabilities is abysmally low. You know, I mean, even the statistical data creates more confusion than clarity. And I generally give this example of my own university, where less than 1% of the total number of seats have the number of applicants, meaning you cannot even think of fulfilling 3% reservation, because even the number of applicants is less than 3%, less than 1%, including all categories of persons with disabilities. It was merely 580 or so in the last year, you know, while even the reserved seats for persons with disabilities would be more than 1500 at undergraduate level. And this is despite the fact that Delhi University has been always in news for making more efforts, more concerted efforts than other universities. And it's a central university. It attracts people from across the country. You know, so, and if you go by this logic, and what you find is that with this less than 1% enrollment, and if you include, you know, all other non-formal, say, private, the distant learning, et cetera, et cetera, then also it will not even be enough to produce sufficient number of candidates to fill whatever is the quantum of reservation, the 3% to 5%. That is the situation. So out of 100 children with disability, we are not able to even provide, you know, to keep it perhaps on a safer side, you know, I mean, not more than one completes graduation. That is the picture of 21st century India. Okay. And the other clarification before I move on is that I have deliberately taken the meaning of the term academia to imply a certain thinking processes, certain pattern of thinking, fine. So of course, there are other kinds of issues why this is happening. There are structural reasons, there are policy flaws, et cetera, but I want to focus on something else, you know, which suits the today's topic of discussion more. So what do you find is that in 2005, we approached the Delhi High Court, we produced a list of those meritorious persons with disabilities who secured ranks, you know, either in their college or in the university or elsewhere, top positions, and who were sent back by different interview boards for college and university positions. And remember, the interview boards are constituted by the members of academic community. So they were sent by the different interview boards as none found suitable. NFS is the bureaucratic jargon for this, fine? In fact, after 25 years, more than 25 years of the first directives of accommodation through reservation by the central government in 1981. After more than 12 years of the Delhi University's own decision to give placement to such people, you know, 3% reservation, through 3% reservation, which they enacted because of, the proactive role played by Professor Bakshi. And after 10 years of the enactment of the Persons with Disabilities Act of 1995, in the year 2005-06, when we placed our tables before the court, we found that no person with disability was appointed under reservation in Delhi University. That is the level of, you know, our academia's biasness towards persons with disabilities, despite all their sympathy, sensitivity, humility, humanity towards us, evident in many, many cases, you know. And this continued, of course, this continues till date, although now there are sterner mechanisms of rosters, etc. But that's one area, you know, where you can see, and it continues. I mean, without revealing much, given my own limitations, what do you find is that in case of other kinds of social marginalizations, if a candidate is appearing before an interview board, either for recruitment or for admission into some study program, as per the rules, you don't have the interview board will not consider the categories. You know, when I mean the interview is happening, you will not see who belongs to which category, right? So that you can place accordingly, you know, I mean, whatever scores is given to them, right? But what happens? I'm not going into the issue, which may be true at many places, that how they are still given low marks, person with disability given low marks, but there is an anomaly. And what is the anomaly? That anyhow, you know, when a person with disability enters the interview board room, he or she is known by her disability, unlike other, you know, kinds of socially marginalized groups, right? Now, I remember when I was in my master's, you know, as a student, and I was doing my master's, there was a dispute over taking a separate room, which I was legally entitled, and so on and so forth. And I remember then, after a long, tortuous battle, some student was allotted my room, and then some supporters came. And without knowing anything about me, without knowing the fact, it doesn't matter, but because this story requires I'm mentioning, without knowing the fact that both at my entry level in graduation and my post-graduation, you know, I was a topper student. Without knowing the fact that I did come through general category, I was told by my student, not batchmates, but I mean the hostel mates, that you know they have made some special provisions for me. That is why I'm there, so I should concede to their demands, you know. And this special, and I really fail to understand. I mean, we have constructed the world in a certain normative pattern where the needs of certain people are treated to be needs. I mean, as genuine, and others' needs are as special. And I really want to understand that whose needs are not special and whose needs are special. What is the objective criteria to decipher this? Who said that only when you write with a pen and paper, it is need, it is necessity, it is ordinary. And when you write with a computer or in braille, it is special, you know? I mean, this is like, and this again reminds me of this older story of 19th century, the princely state of Kolhapur, where when Saiji Rao instituted certain measures for progressive discrimination in education and employment, and which instigated a lot of opposition, and then he took, you know, when this was reported to him by his prime minister, he took him to, you know, the stable, jahan ghode rakhe jate, and then he asked the guy who took care of the houses there to just spread some food on the floor. And then certain horses came and they ate more than others. And then half of the truth, the prime minister immediately understood, you know, that if you know, there is an open competition, then, you know, some people will take more and some will be left behind. Now, is it good? Is a question for all of you to think. But then the half of the other half, you know, the king explained to the prime minister, saying that this has not happened today. Over centuries, some discrimination, some prejudices, something led, something, you know, into the deprivation of certain people, certain horses, which which, I mean, that difference then got accumulated over the centuries, over generations. So in order to mitigate that difference, you have to adopt a model of progressive discrimination today. But the problem today before the academia is that most of the academia seems to have been almost bought or has become complicit in the paradigm shift in our policy framework. And remember, policies for persons with disabilities cannot belong to a different realm. They belong to the same realm to which belong the other policies. So if today the social justice agenda is under threat because of the market ideologies of neoliberalism, because of a variety of other factors, then the disability rights and policies cannot remain. Even if they remain an exception, it will be only a rhetoric. They cannot remain an exception, you know. So today, if the entire social justice agenda is under threat, and if the academia has not been able to see it beyond the narrow confines of identity politics, to see that differently marginalized social groups constitute the bulk of majority of Indian society, and if a paradigm does not suit those differently marginalized groups, including persons with disabilities, then, you know, it can never grant them social justice. And without that social justice, at best what will happen and what is happening is that, barring some exceptions, the justice is met out to people even from within the marginalized communities, including, you know, the community of persons with disabilities, to a select few. So they themselves become an elite within those communities, you know. So our policy paradigm is neither capable of fighting the prejudices effectively, and I can elaborate it when it comes to discussion, nor we have been able to actually secure social justice in any meaningful manner and degree despite 73 years of our independence. That is the hard truth of our society. You know, I remember, and that's the last point, when I made this statement of the blur in, you know, our edited volume, which is coming from Audit Black Swan, hopefully in a couple of months, on education and inequality, you know, that 85% of our population is not able to, in the relevant age group, is not able to complete formal schooling. You know, even the core group was taken aback for a while. Of course, we agreed. So we have to really, I think we have to undo a lot that we have learned so far to understand the real picture of Indian society. We cannot be misguided by the crowd that you see at the time of admission in the university or colleges, you know, in the month of May, June, July, whatever, you know, I mean, particularly in universities like Delhi or elsewhere, which are more renowned, you know, because in a big population, anything can get a big crowd. But if you see it statistically, it's a tiny, very tiny fraction of our population which has got benefit. That's what I want to say today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta, for showing us or painting the very sad picture of how people with disability are actually, what have we met, what have we achieved so far, and what is the what are the things that we still need to do. So it's very it was very disturbing to know that very less people can actually reach up to the stage of graduation, and very less actually make it to graduation. And yes, there can be nothing worse than a disability becoming the identity of a person. That is something I think the society does as the first thing they see a person with disabilities. And yes, very correctly pointed out that we need to redefine terms like needs or special, you know, how we define them. It's very different, and a lot needs to be done in that direction. I would like to, Manujendu has given a very nice comment here, and he says, all of us who use glasses for vision correction would have been disabled a couple of centuries ago. We need to understand that each one of us is likely to be disabled in some manner. We need to appreciate that our prejudices need to be dealt with, and our approach to life needs to change. Yes, certainly there is a lot that also needs to be done at the policy levels. And thank you for your comments on this, Dr. Gupta. We now move on to our next panelist, Dr. Mrityunjay Verma. Dr. Verma, can you please share your ideas on this topic?
So thanks, Rohini. I begin by thanking the organizers for inviting me to be part of this effort which you people are taking. I will be able to tell mostly about my experiences. I belong to a very small city, which is Balia district in UP. So it's a very small district and not much. But thanks to my family, I was given a good education. And then after 12th, I moved to Mumbai. So everyone at home was very worried what will happen, how I will travel and so on. But once I moved there, it was not that difficult. Because I found a kind of different family there, and the kind of people I was interacting with and I was with, they were very nice. And I never felt any difference that due to my problems, I have to face anything. But that was mostly because, those people were very nice. And then I moved to Allahabad for my Harishchandra Research Institute. And there also I had no trouble. And after that, I went to Italy for my postdoc. In all this journey, I had never, I never faced any trouble whatsoever regarding, my problems and so on. This was mostly because the people in academia, with whom I interact, they are in general very supportive. Whenever you have any problems, people come. But these are my experiences. But I think in general, people with disability, they can face various hurdles in life. So for example, I was looking at some data just before joining this group meeting. The data says that in 2003-04, around 2.2% people were disabled, who had registered as disabled in academia. And that number went to 3.9% in 2012 and 13. But this should be contrasted with the number of working age adults, which is 16%, which is the data of 2014. So definitely there is participation of disabled people in academia is less, very less compared to all working age people. So I think this needs some encouragement and so on. I don't know what is the way. For my work is mostly theoretical, so I don't have to roam around and do things. So that is why I think I get by. But in general, if someone has to, this disability, of course, limits what kind of work you can do. Definitely, there are some things which one can find and do. So one needs to give disabled people some kind of direction, what they can pursue, what kind of interest they can generate. So this needs to be done from a very early age. In our society as such, I think in big cities, people do get lot of, motivational things. But in small cities, it's not that common. The kind of support system they need, they might need. So I think, this is a good initiative. That's all I have to say for now.
Okay, thank you, Mrityunjay. Yeah, you made a very nice point about the directions that certain people might need while going for certain careers or a specialized or going for any kind of education. And these directions, if given early on, can actually instill confidence in a person and can take the person wherever that person wants to go to. I mean, it's not impossible at all. It is just a matter of how early you start giving directions or how early you actually instill confidence in that person. And that is the need of the hour. I would like to मैं जानना चाहूंगी आपसे कि जब आप अपने अपने शहर से दूसरे शहर में मुंबई जैसे शहर में आए तो आपको किन तकलीफों का सामना करना पड़ा और आपने किस तरह से उसे आप किस तरह से उसको आपने एक्सेप्ट किया और आप आगे आए, क्या आप उसपे उसके ऊपर कुछ कहना चाहोगे?
आई थिंक जब मैं पहली बार गया तो इट वॉज नॉट दैट डिफिकल्ट, मतलब आई वेंट विथ माई फादर, बट वंस ही लेफ्ट मी देयर, सिंस देन आई वॉज ट्रेवलिंग टू एंड फ्रॉम मुंबई अलोन इन ट्रेन, ट्रेवलिंग इन ट्रेन एंड सो ऑन, सो दैट वॉज नॉट, आई मीन आई जनरेटेड सम कॉन्फिडेंस, आई थिंक दैट वॉज हेल्पफुल, एंड सिंस देन आई मीन आई हैव ऑल्सो ट्रेवल्ड abroad alone, so I think that was not a people in general help, so that was the point. And while living in Mumbai in the university, I mean we had like everything we wanted and we might need, so
मैं हमारे श्रोताओं को बता दूं कि मुंबई में हम जैसे लोगों को ही या किसी को भी लोकल ट्रेन में ट्रैवल करना ये एक बहुत बड़ी समस्या होती है. और डॉक्टर मृत्युंजय वर्मा ने जिस तरह से बताया कि बड़ी आसानी से वो कर सके इसमें ट्रैवल, एक मोटर डिसेबिलिटी के साथ ट्रैवल करना हम समझ सकते हैं कितना मुश्किल जाता होगा. जब आपको ब्रिज क्रॉस करना पड़ता है आपको 10 बार सोचना पड़ता है कि मैं अभी चढ़ूँ या मैं 5 मिनट रुक के चढ़ूँ, तो ये सब बातें और भी ज़्यादा तकलीफ बढ़ा देती है जब जब आपको सहायता की जरूरत होती है. लेकिन जिस तरह से उन्होंने बताया कि उन्हें उन्हें डेफिनेटली उतना कॉन्फिडेंस था और वो बड़े आराम से ट्रैवल भी कर पाए और आज वो इटली में है, वो अकेले गए हैं वहां पे बिना किसी सहायता से, तो ये बहुत अच्छी बात है. डॉक्टर मृत्युंजय, रियली हैप्पी टू नो दैट. एंड वी वुड नाउ वांट टू नो फ्रॉम सोनम. सोनम, आई वुड लाइक टू आस्क यू अबाउट the cognitive difficulties that students face and how you provide assistance.
Okay, first of all, thank you for having me here, everyone. And I'll have to say first of all that so far, last 12 years of my experience is limited to the school going age. Like we start working when child enters the school, sometimes in pre-primary, primary, and so far, till now, it is till what we can say standard 10. So it's a primary, middle, and higher schooling. So my focus will be more on cognitive difficulties they are facing and what we are doing. Of course, I have to agree that there are many, many things need to be done for them. Even as I we were discussing Rohini that day, that even labeling a child is, I think, it also a problem. If you know, we keep on doing it again and again. So just to start with, what I would really like to open up with some kind of not explanation, but just gist about what they are and what I'm going to concentrate about. So the spectrum, which of cognitive disorders or difficulties we can say, it ranges from lower prevalence, that is less common but higher in severity, to high prevalence to low severity. They are very common, but they are less severe. That means these of the students or these of the children are very, very successful in a normal day-to-day schooling. And they should be included as, you know, as we are talking about inclusion everywhere. I would just like to add that in Podar, we have inclusive education sales made by counselors, counseling psychologists, which works on how they include in day-to-day normal schooling. Without, of course, we need to take steps for that. It's just going on. So I was talking about low prevalence, higher severity disorders, which are, we can talk intellectual disabilities. Then to high prevalence and lower severity means it ranges till reading disorders, that is dyslexia, severe learning disability. There are SLDs, dyscalculia is very common, dyslexia we all have heard, and very, very severe ADHD also. Like I'm talking about attention deficit hyperactive disorder, which in which a student needs to take certain medicines to, you know, slow down the hyperactivity. This is a severe level ADHD. It is very common nowadays. There are many researches made, and it is said now that even in India, one in every 10 students is at risk of some kind of SLDs. Some kind of SLDs or special needs child. So basically, we all know that cognitive skills which are tapped in our general curriculum is knowledge, comprehension, that is understanding what is being communicated. It is related to applications as well as analysis, that is breaking down the information into parts, see the relationships between ideas. Also the synthesis, making something new by organizing whatever the analysis and application. Also, it also about evaluation, that is deciding which method is okay, you know, problem solving in gist. So what happens with, this is all cognitive. We say this is our cognitive functions. With the kids who are having issues with cognitive impairments or SLDs now, for the more common word, we will use that. They have problems with all of these processes somewhere. Sometimes it is recognizable, it can be diagnosed, but most of the time it really cannot be diagnosed. It is too minor as per we can go. Like there are researches done on dyslexic brain, CT scan, there are various scans, but in normal day-to-day life functioning, if we go on diagnosing the child, we are more you know, dependent on psychometric testing. There are various screening lists, various psychometric tests, which tells us what can be a problem with child. There can be many simple checklist criteria for teachers to understand, ki, okay, this child is not able to sit, so this may be a problem. Then if they have access to a counselor, then they go to the counselor and tell them that these are the things happening. And then it is about counselor's point of view, and it is actually a work of system, how they are trying to include the child, what you are doing to do that. Because there are sometimes they are unable to pay attention, even for a short period, 10, 15 minutes lesson time or 10, 15 minutes sitting at one place can be a very big issue with kids. Then extraordinary long time to complete the sets, weak listening skills, they are unable to remember the instructions. So multi-level instructions to bhool hi jao. There are one and two step instructions which are really difficult. Then struggling, planning, prioritizing, you know, they struggle with, you know, planning the things, how to tackle what problem. But what I really like to say is these are the skills which child learns. And a special child, a child with a special needs, learns all these skills in a different time zone. And we can say in some more time than maybe in your words, a normal kid do. For me, they both are normal. The wavelength is just differs. They are at one end of the spectrum and other kids are just another end of spectrum. It's about how we help them. And I would also like to, you know, really bring on the fact that all the time, we really need to look beyond our sets, you know, how to evaluate the thing. Evaluation is something I think we really need to worry about. It's not only how many marks you are getting in exams, okay? It's not how you are writing, whether you are writing in the boundaries and whether you are having that, you know, handwriting, recognizable, unrecognizable. It is about you, you know, it is about you giving chance to your kid or your student, if you are a teacher, to express himself or, you know, you are giving him all the inputs which enable him to, you know, find his place in the society. If we talk about CBSE curriculum, There is a book which CBSE publish every year about what are the expected criteria and what are the things. Last year, in that label, when they were telling us about the whatever the things we can do and whatever the provisions we can provide, there was a tagline and I liked it like anything. They said, don't label. Don't label is the tagline of that. They are expecting us, and that what we are doing, we try to identify what can be an issue, and we start working on the difficulty. It is better, because I feel inclusion is the necessity of the time. Of course, inclusion is very difficult, because in our classroom, we are having more than 30 students. Inclusion is very much possible when there are 5 or 6 people in a classroom. A teacher can include the special need kids very positively, but I must say, with little bit of adjustment, inclusion is possible up to certain level, even in our setup, Indian setup. Of course, for that, a teacher, a school, as well as a student's parent, all the people involved really need to have a very open mindset. You need to think beyond that. For paper, in question paper, I need to answer in 5 lines. Then only I will get 5 marks. No, it is not like that. You have to understand that if I'm able to explain the syllabus or whatever chapter you're teaching in a tree diagram, in a doodle manner, that is also my way of answering your question. And that is also tells you about my creativity, you know, because ultimately when we are talking about cognition, we are talking about right and left brain. When I'm talking about tabletop skills like writing, answering, I'm talking about my one side of brain, which is obviously left brain, which is more concrete. But when I'm doing something so creative, we are forgetting that that child whom we are labeling as a special child is having a right side of the brain completely intact. He's very creative. He can give you answers in abstract manner, maybe. You just need to tap on that. So my focus is on early tapping of the problem, early diagnosis. And then I'm just building about the support system to that kid so that he will be having lesser issues in fitting in the society, you see. So far, we are trying hard, and at least in my limited circle, because I work for a certain institute and I have to work there. So yes, we are, you know, step by step, we are improving ourselves. We are learning in a way, and it's a lovely process. Thank you.
Thank you, Sonam, for your views. And I must say that there are a lot of things which we take for granted. So for instance, you know, the fact that you mentioned that a teacher may not know what is the problem with a child, because it may just go undiagnosed. He or she may not understand why the child is not able to solve or write a line or write a word. But yes, you also have spoken about different tests or different checklists that a teacher can follow without having to label the child or to say something to the child. So then the teacher also knows, okay, this is what the child can do better or can do really nicely. And what you said about, you know, the 5 lines answer, I really like that. I was discussing with an educator last week about, you know, students, everybody tends to say, okay, this is the right answer, 5 lines and you get all marks, 4 lines and you don't get all marks.
We have all learned in that way. You see, if there is 2 pages answers, you are getting all 20 marks. Nobody bothers to read the answer and understand what the child has written. I have suffered a lot because of this. I was undiagnosed dysgraphic when I was going through the learning age. And my difficulty was diagnosed by me and my friend when we were doing experiment in Mumbai University in the lab, when we were doing the test and all. And that time I came to know that I am a borderline dysgraphic. That means I am unable to understand the 3-dimensional things which move around. So it is very difficult for me now as well to, you know, understand the address, understand the maps. My brain just can't do that. But that doesn't make me abnormal, right? I'm able to drive a car. I'm able to do almost all the things. I just need a help in particular thing. And there is nothing wrong in it. So it was as naturally came to me, because nobody bothered treating me specially also, I must say that. But in today's generation, I doubt if somebody is having some kind of difficulty. I'm afraid that he or she will be labeled, and it may affect very badly. And other side, on the other end of spectrum, if he is labeled, he will not able to get help only. Matlab, uska, if I'm labeling a child, he will not try to, you know, expand his or her limitations. He will just say, okay, I'm this na, toh mujhe ye problem hai. So let me have all the things which come with it. So it is, you know, a two-way things. We have to be really very careful about it. Balanced approach is needed, basically.
Right. And I really like this point on allowing to express oneself. I think it's common for everyone, because a child may have his or her own ways to write, to express her views, his views on a particular topic. And like we said, that not everybody can you know, be good at everything. We expect a lot from people. And like what I had read in a particular article was that teachers very easily say that, okay, this is easy. You know, solve this problem, it's easy. It may not be easy for everyone. Like I'm still a maths phobia. I have a phobia for maths. I cannot solve any question if you just give me. So it's not everything is easy for everyone. So if teachers don't say this, it'll be very, very, it'll be a nice place to be. A maths classroom will be a nice place for me, person like me.
No, I agree and completely get your point.
Yeah, so I really, it's nice to hear from all of you. And now we move on to our fourth panelist, that is Swagata. Swagata, we would like to hear from you on ableism in academia. Hello, Swagata, you're on mute.
Okay. Thank you, Rohini. Thank you, Aniket. And thank you, all the other organizers, for inviting me to speak in this forum. I would also like to thank my co-panelists for broadening my education on this topic. It was a very nice seminar till now. Okay. The brief that I was given by Aniket was to talk about the angle of mental health. Let me begin with this disclaimer. As my bio says, I'm not an expert on mental health. My qualification of being in this panel is that I am a patient of mental illness for the past 23 years now, and I am ready to talk about it openly. That is my way of battling the stigma of mental illness. Now, I myself have had a very privileged life with, in spite of the mental illness. How? Because I have had very supportive family, very supportive friends, very supportive teachers and mentors who have all helped me come to reach the point where I have reached. But in spite of this extremely privileged environment which I have been in, always been in, I have still felt the sting of stigma and the harassment that comes with stigma in my immediate environment.
Sorry, therefore, Swagata. Can you please tilt your screen? We can't see you. Yeah, that's better.
Is this better? Yeah.
Yeah.
So the stigma of mental illness is one of the topics which I will address during this. Now, when I was given the brief, being a mathematician, the first thing I did was go in search of a definition of what mental illness is. I'll not bore you people with all the definitions, but I'll just give a few lines which resonated with me. These I found in the NIH Biological Curriculum Study books. Not all brain diseases are categorized as mental illnesses. As scientists continue to investigate the brains of people who have mental illnesses, they are learning that mental illness is associated with changes in the brain structure, chemistry, and function, and that mental illness does indeed have a biological basis. This ongoing research is in some ways causing scientists to minimize the distinction between mental illnesses and these other brain disorders. So that ends the quote. And this is how I view mental illness, a health condition, often chronic, that can seriously impair one's functioning and negatively affect one's life. Now, mental illnesses are amongst the most common and mostly hidden causes of disability worldwide. about 23% of all years lost because of disability are due to mental and substance use disorders. The situation in India is very dire. Getting data on this subject is very difficult. And again, I'm not an expert, but from whatever I've been able to get, the paper in Lancet Psychiatry in 2020, published in 2020, that in 2017, 197.3 million people had mental disorders in India. That is actually one in seven Indians were affected by mental disorders of varying severity in 2017. Now, if you people, if all of you think, you will realize that you don't know too many people whom you know to have mental illnesses. One of the reasons, I think the main reason, is people try to hide it because of stigma. Now, what is the problem with hiding? People with mental illnesses often tend to live shorter lives as compared to the general populace. In fact, if you have a severe mental illness, your life expectancy can be, a reduction can be as high as 10 to 25 years. The vast majority of these deaths are due to chronic physical medical conditions such as cardiovascular, respiratory, and infectious diseases, diabetes, and hypertension. Another important cause of death amongst people with mental illness is suicide. Now, every year, all over the world, it is estimated, it's not known, it's estimated that 800,000 people die due to suicide. And every suicide has an estimated 20 unsuccessful suicide attempts behind them. There is a very high degree of correlation between suicide and mental illness. Attempted suicides can often be saved, can lead happy and healthy lives, provided they get timely and appropriate help. The physical illnesses suffered by patients of mental disorders are often associated with preventable risk factors. Now, they also have to get help. That is often stopped by the stigma. Now I come to the academia. For some reason, the academia has a large burden of mental health problems. Again, due to this culture of hiding, I did not find any data as to how many senior academics suffer from mental health illnesses. However, there was a recent newspaper article which said that in India, 30% of the research scholars, that is PhD students, suffered from some type of mental illness. Now, some of them were pre-existing conditions when they came to PhD. Some started, they were triggered when they were in PhD, while they were doing their PhD. Fifth Nature survey of PhD students in 2017 gave the following risk factors for the graduate students. The risk factors are training, work-life balance, bullying and harassment, student debt, and carer responsibilities. These are mainly, the survey was in the United States. In the Indian context, I would say student debt is not such a major concern, not in the sense that they mean. But Indians have another burden, that's the burden of societal and familial expectations. Somehow people refuse to see a PhD as a job. There is a undue pressure, familial pressure, societal pressure, that, oh, you need to get into a job, you need to get married, you need to have kids, you need to start earning, till when will you put your life on hold because of this research? That itself creates a tremendous amount of stress. the projection of societal and familial expectations on scholars of uncertain future, while their contemporaries are often rising steadily in their chosen profession, in say, industry, that is the age where people start rising very rapidly, when while others are doing their PhD, can often take their toll. So there is another peculiarly Indian problem. There's an age limit to faculty and other scientific jobs in publicly funded institutes. Now, I have known many research scholars who do not have any disability, mental or physical, to cross the age limit with PhD, because age limit for a job, just with PhD and a couple of postdocs, because research does take time and we don't know how long it is going to take. For people with mental disability, suppose due to the illness, you have to take a couple of years off somewhere around your career. You're doomed. You're never going to get a job. Now the Rights to Persons with Disability Act of 2016 does provide a remedy for that. It gives a relaxation of this limit. I think it's 5 years. I'm not sure, but yeah, I think it's 5 years. But it only applies to patients with benchmark disabilities, that is, with greater than 40% disabilities. Now, with mental illnesses, with moderate mental illnesses, which might make you take years off, they might not reach this benchmark. So the act did not actually provide any solution to this. I have talked about this to other people, but to people in power, and they are, but now there is this act. The act is useless. The act is useless in this sense. Yeah. So, mental illnesses are caused by a combination of environmental, physical, and genetic factors. And the stress of PhD life can be a trigger for me. So counseling services are mandatory in institutes, and most top institutes do have it. But they are often not enough. First of all, if it's a large institute, the counseling services are overworked. The people do not get the help when they actually need it, or do not get enough time within the services. Another thing is that if you are working in a place, you might not want to use their mental health services because you are afraid of discrimination and the stigma. So the stigma involves the misconception is that mainstream medicine cannot treat mental illnesses. In India also, there is a refusal by physicians who are not psychiatric to even take mental illness seriously. Then there are these people, these schools of positive thinking, which put the onus of getting out of the mental illness on the shoulders of their patients, actually blaming the patients for their condition and for their sins. You yourself talked about the people talking about the sins of parents. So similarly, with mental illnesses, this is there. The stigma involves negative attitudes towards patients due to mental illnesses and sometimes towards their families. The public stigma is often the reason why concealment of the illness is the first concern of the patient's family, patient and the family, and that can compromise on the care of the patient. It can worsen the illness, stop people from getting help, and delaying recovery. Okay. Now, in outside world, I am saying off campuses, there is a severe shortage of mental health professionals in India. Now, nobody knows exactly how many psychiatrists and mental health professionals are there in India, but there's I have looked at various sources. So I'm quoting what the Minister of State for Health and Family Welfare told the Lok Sabha in 2018. She said that there were 3,827 registered psychiatrists, while India needed 13,500. And there are clinical psychologists, India needs above 20,000, some 20,250, while it had only 898. United States, in comparison, had 28,000 registered psychiatrists. Their population is actually much less than ours is. Also, most of these mental health professionals worked in tier one cities. So people in the smaller cities, in remote areas, in villages, have to go hundreds of kilometers to be able to even access mental health care. Imagine you are very ill, you are not in a position to do any of that, and you cannot contact your healthcare professional. So another stigma is that the mental health patients are often conceived as difficult, unreasonable, and incapable of making their decisions. And if the mental health patient is a woman, then so there is nothing like it. As Professor Shubha Tole was talking about, even women without any kind of disability were told to calm down in faculty meetings. These with mental health patients, one favorite line of most male colleagues would be, she is being hysterical. So the word hysterical comes from the word hysteria, which is the word for uterus. It was supposed to be a mental illness in the 19th century, which was arising out of some problems in the uterus. One excellent play or movie which deals with this subject is Proof. It's a mainstream movie, so I'm sure a lot of people have at least heard of it. So imagine what a mentally ill woman will have to face. A mentally ill, highly qualified woman working in a male atmosphere. So again, the Act of 2016 has provisions for punishments of people who intentionally insult or intimidate with the intent to humiliate a person with a disability in any place within public view. However, I do not know of any case that has, any prosecution that has taken place with respect to mental illness. Similarly, there are a lot of provisions in the Mental Health Care Act of 2017. Finally, one of the reasons why people don't open up about mental illness, or even don't acknowledge to themselves that they might have a mental illness, that they might need help, mental health care intervention, is, I'll just take 1 minute. I'm sorry, I'm over time. Is that there's a misconception that patients with mental disorder are somehow inferior intellectually. So this is a laughable idea. I will give a list of creative, both artistic and scientific geniuses to you. People like John Nash, C.P. Ramanujam, Kurt Gödel, Ludwig Boltzmann, Vincent van Gogh, Virginia Woolf, Sylvia Plath, Edvard Munch, Mozart. Now, I'm not saying that everybody with a mental disorder is a genius, but there is enough instances of people with mental disorders with extraordinary creative abilities that we can correlate the two. And research is going on this. I end with this saying by Edvard Munch: I cannot get rid of my illnesses, for there is a lot in my art that exists only because of them. Thank you. I'm sorry for going over time.
No worries. Thank you, Swagata, for your views. You mentioned the name of a movie. Can you please write it in the comment chat so that people can...
Yes, get Proof. Yes. It's a very short name, Proof. I'll also write it in the comment chat.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I really like many, many good points that you brought about, and some which we know already, but we just don't talk about them, like hiding someone's, hiding this emotional needs or emotional disabilities. And of course, PhD can be a Herculean task for anyone. I mean, not just a woman or someone who needs emotional support, but on top of that, if there is a family pressure, if there are other things, and when people say that, okay, you're putting your life on hold, then one can only understand what that pressure is and how people actually yield to that pressure. And then we see a lot of issues coming up with students. And certainly we need to work on how to how to set these age limits, whether you need age limits in the first place.
Yes.
Especially in any context.
Exactly. I spoke on this context because it seemed relevant at this point. But any context, do we need age limits?
Yeah, correct. I also, I remembered something when you were telling about mental illness and how doctors view this. Mm. So there was some post on social media which said that, you know, people tend to say that, okay, it's all in your head. The moment you say, I feel this, I feel pressurized, people say it's all in your head. And then it's similar to saying an asthma patient that it's all in your lungs. So, it is also something that needs medical attention.
Attention. And not only that, I have had experiences with medical doctors who have told me, why are you taking all these medicines for your mental illness? Why don't you just go for a walk? It was only when I was telling him not to prescribe me a painkiller, because it would have been, with the other medications, it wouldn't have worked. And he was like, no, you'd stop these other medications. I was like, okay, I will do that if you write it in a prescription. And that was when he became afraid and he stopped. If educated, qualified people, and this guy was quite famous in our area, come up with this, then what kind of help or information can you expect from the society at large?
True. Very important questions raised. And while we were discussing, there was also a discussion that was happening on the chat that was about what are the terms that people use, or what are terms that should be used. Like should we say people with disability? Should we say temporarily abled? Or we say a person with special disabilities? So I think with that, I don't know if that discussion actually,
even I saw some of that.
Yeah.
So mine is that we should, I would prefer myself as a person with disability. Disability is not my primary identity, but at the same time, it affects a lot on how I function. So I'm just a person with disability. I am not a person with any special or anything divine, any divine body part.
Yeah, thank you for that. Do the other panelists want to say something on this? Because we spoke about terms and we spoke about labeling.
For my field when I work, we have a simple term: different students with special needs. It's just that, and it is like we are not judging, because under special needs, the kids which really need more help in academic also comes, but also there are other spectrums involved also, like autism or mental impairment. So yes, the students with special needs is the term which we would prefer using.
So we have now questions from the
No, I'm just adding basically that what is happening is that if you see the scholarship that is available to us on disability rights movements, etc., what you find is that whilst the official documents and even quite a lot of academic discourse now uses the term persons with disabilities, of course, each terms have their own limitations, but, you know, I mean, and on the other hand, you know, more politically meant discourse uses the term, you know, disabled people. And very often people get even confused, you know, when somebody says disabled people, because they think that by using the term disabled, you mean to refer to something very, very negative, which is that, you know, a body is disabled. But the same scholarship then clarifies that, you know, this political usage of the term, you know, which seeks for social political interventions, refers to disablement as something which is socially constituted, you know, some that the human body, for example, is not something as disabled, but it is being disabled by the outside environment and the behavior of the other people. You know, so there is, in fact, a lot of discussion that has already taken place in the disability studies, field of disability studies. And of course, the I'm sorry for forgetting the name, but as our, you know, psychologist friend said, that the term special needs continues to be used till date, even though we really don't know, as I said, you know, what is special and what is not so special. Why my needs are special and why your needs are not so special is something which is still not known. And it's this last sub point about it is, I mean, it's obvious, because even the definition of disability and therefore the resultant numbers of persons with disabilities vary so much. If at one hand you have, you know, these very low figures of the Census of India and the NSSO, you know, which is less than 3%. Then on the other hand, the global, you know, disability prevalence figures as calculated by World Health Organization and, you know, adhere to many other nations are much higher. You know, I mean, they are in most of the cases between 10 to 15%. So, you know, there does exist a lot of diversity about the usage of terms. Nonetheless, there are certain terms like, you know, special needs children, or even persons with differently abled persons. You know, I mean, I remember even the earlier Chief Commissioner of Persons with Disabilities, who was also the representative of India in the formulation of United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. And I mean, he kept saying that, I mean, why am I a differently abled person? Each individual is differently abled. Each one of us does things differently. So these are very, very complicated matters. But therefore, it's important to flag these issues, even if we are not able to resolve them, so that we are not using them very comfortably. That will lead us to more and more refinement. And as Swagatam ji rightly said, hinted rather, you know, we don't possess any divine organ. I mean, it's very, very unfortunate that contrary to the idea of social justice, a non-secular divine origin theory in the name of Divyang has been initiated. It's very, very unfortunate.
We have we can now start the question and answer session. So Aniket, you can ask your question to the panelists.
My question to the panelists was that what concrete steps would you like to see in higher education or academia in near future, so that the system becomes more inclusive? Like Swagata has spoken about the stigma attached to mental health. What can we do to protect people who seek help?
I think a sensitization is necessary, and sensitization is right in the first year. So you cannot have a sensitization in the third or fourth year, and because by that time a lot of people will already have suffered. Not only that, information is required. I was told by a student in the third year, whose parents are doctors, that before a course she attended as part of her curriculum, she didn't know that addictions are mental health problems. She thought they just are, and people should get over it, and it's their fault. And she is not, in general, a person who is insensitive to the needs of others. At the same time, in the hostel that she lives in, she would have seen a lot of people who are struggling with addictions. With in every hostel, there are people struggling with addiction. So it is important to acknowledge the problem, important to inform people about it, important for people to come out and speak about it.
Thank you, Swagata, for that. We now have two questions coming from Professor Prajwal Shastri. Professor Prajwal, you can ask your questions.
Hi, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yeah, so I think one of the things we would like to take away from this discussion series is what, as Aniket asked, can we do in practical terms? And from listening to all the participants today, as well as the previous participants, it seems that we have to think in two different directions. One is, what are the large scale structural changes that we need? But there is perhaps also an opportunity to think in terms of what are the bottom up changes that can be made if individual institutions can be persuaded to take initiative and bring about change within their institutions. And the latter is typically, obviously, easier. But the problem there is that many people, even though they are enthusiastic to transform their climate into a more inclusive one and so on, may not know where to start. So it would be useful to give some sort of template to such institutions. So it would be nice if we can come up with, not necessarily in the next 20 minutes or so, but working on it, come up with some sort of guidelines for institutions which they can then implement in their own institutions. So for example, like what Swagata said, sensitization and training programs. And she talked about first year and second year. I would say that those have to happen for the leadership as well. But the panelists should talk about what kind of training programs are effective. Are there models that we can use? Are they in place elsewhere? So that's one thing. Second thing is about, code of conduct that we try to do along the gender dimension, but it can be along other dimensions as well. A code of conduct that we adopt for the everyday climate, for conferences, for the teaching in the classroom and so on. So along these lines, can we have people opine, the panelists opine?
Aniket asked me a question. So I think in my case, as you said, my friends.
Can you just repeat the question for people who are not?
I'll read out the question. So the question to Mrityunjay is, आपने कहा कि आपको हमेशा से अच्छा सपोर्ट मिला, मगर क्या आपको लगता है कि आपकी या आपके दोस्तों की करियर चॉइस आपके शारीरिक क्षमताओं पर निर्भर थी?
Yes, so नहीं, I think हम लोग का करियर चॉइस इट वाज बेस्ड ऑन व्हाट वी वर इंटरेस्टेड इन.
Okay.
Yes.
There is one question from Anisa. I'll just read the question out. Swagata mentioned that a person with mental illness faces harassment because of the stigma associated with it. What about the reverse process? When a person becomes mentally ill, as per the definition that we are discussing, because of some form of harassment or something which is perceived as one faced by him or her? Or does this lead to a vicious cycle of some sort? Should I repeat the question?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So the question is, what about the, like you mentioned about the mental process. Swagata just mentioned about the mental illness that a person faces, harassment because of the stigma associated with it. What about the reverse process when a person becomes mentally ill as per the definition because of some form of harassment or something which is perceived as one faced by him or her? Or does this lead to a vicious cycle of some sort? I think it's about she's asking about what about when a person becomes ill rather than when mental illness is a pre-existing condition. So she's asking about a second possibility.
Yeah, I think she's also asking about if the illness is due to some kind of harassment.
Yeah, that.
So I think the best person to advise her would be a mental health professional, not any of us. We can talk about the society that we live in. In most cases of harassment, there are remedies available.
Okay. Any other panelists would like to address this? Okay. Yeah, we are please feel free to post your questions on the Zoom chat. There's a question from Ranjit to everyone. Is there a difference between labeling and identifying? If one is in denial of identification, how can it be treated? I'll repeat the question. Is there a difference between labeling and identifying? If one is in denial of identification, how can it be treated?
Well, I think it will vary from context to context, but labeling is where you see a person only from that particular lens, that it's like you're not looking at, at a woman who is a person with disability as a woman. You are only looking at, and necessarily always looking at her as a disabled, So it could be the reverse as well. So, labeling refers to something of that kind. While identification refers to, of course, identifying. And in our case, for example, our disability. And I don't think that there is anybody who is saying that don't identify our disability. In fact, on the contrary, there is a battle for identification, which even in concrete terms is manifested when somebody has difficulty in getting a disability certificate made, but then if you want this identity to be inscribed even on our general identification cards, for example, my voter ID, my Aadhaar, my everywhere, without seeking my consent, then comes the problem with the identification. In the document which is meant for identification of my disability, identifying disability is something that I think every disabled person would want. But on the other hand, if this becomes something all pervasive, so that suppose there is a possibility of being victimized by the prejudice of the others, and I want to therefore simply apply for that thing online without mentioning that I'm a person with disability, and then it becomes difficult. Suppose tomorrow, it's a very hypothetical thing, even the email starts saying, okay, so this is an email from a visually impaired person. How will I ensure that when my essay goes to, EPW or any other journal, it is just on its merit rather than, with an so there is that, choice, which if it is eliminated, comes the problem with the identification. Because that then compromises that entire agency to take a decision, where it is appropriate to behave in what way. It's not about hiding. It's about, negotiating. Each one of us, whether we are persons with disability or not, we decide how do we present ourselves. Before children, we present ourselves differently. before teacher, we present ourselves differently. You know, so it's that kind of a freedom that we want.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. Sonam, would you like to share something on this?
I agree with the first part Dr. Gupta said, that labeling is a very perceived term. When I label a person, I don't necessarily know what is going on or what is exactly wrong. It is just my perception that person is so and so. But instead of identifying, I will go more with diagnosing and getting the help which is needed. Because as I already told, I'm looking at a child's perspective. Okay, so I'm starting at the early level when we tap a problem, that if the child is having some kind of difficulty or special learning necessity. So here, yes, the denial is there in parents as well as teachers, that if I say something to a student or a parent, try to say that I think this is going to be a difficulty and I need to understand more, then there, yes, there is a denial of the parent. So that needs to be addressed over here. The parents needs to be comfortable in the thought process that, okay, there are some kind of difficulties happening in teaching learning process with the child's level of understanding or child's level of cognition, and it can be addressed very well and very successfully. So you have to make them realize that, yes, there is some issues, but you have to do it, empathetically. Not something like, there is something wrong. It's how you basically open up to the person. Sensitivity, sensitization is needed on all the levels. But again, it again attaches, or it is extended in a question asked earlier over here, that what you will do to, sensitize the person. It's not only in higher studies, even in a school thing, we need to be very cautious about how we are talking about that particular student. How you're discussing, whether you are gossiping about that person or a student in your teacher room. If you are, for example, I have a CP child in my school. Initially, when she admitted, she had both the inability to walk and all. We have done a lot of things to make her walk. There was some kind of provisions made in the school. And we had to work equally hard on stopping teachers discussing about all those changes, because even though you talk about in a such a casual manner, it hurts those students' sensitivities. So denial in all the form is needed to be addressed very sensitively over here. So yes, that is to be something we need to work on all the levels.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Gupta and Sonam, for your answers. And yes, we really need to think about how this can be addressed, and who, like, it's not just the student or the parent or the teacher, a lot of people.
Everyone
who's in interaction with everyone else needs to understand what this is and how.
Denial comes into the fear that, Dr. Gupta said, ki agar mera bachcha identify ho gaya ki dyslexic hai, toh har jagah pe usko usi ka samna karna padega. He will be identified by his disability and not because of his or her abilities. So that's why the basic reason of denial is there. So we as a society needs to really work on how to, normalize all these terms and how to use it very positively. Small things are needed. The teacher's talk can be arranged.
In addition to denial, in fact, it's not rather denial, a kind of a fear, as she said. At the same time, there is that other side also, which I hinted, which is, if we are discussing the demand, the denial side, then there is the other side, which is the demand side. Because in many, many cases, and we did fight many, many cases, many, many problems we represented to different governmental bodies and legislative bodies, the judicial bodies, the demand to, in fact, get the recognition of their disability. There are both sides of it. If at one hand, there are cases where people get a bit concerned that, my I'm going to be identified as a person with dyslexia or as a person with mental whatever impairedness or whatever. Then on the other hand is also this truth that people till date keep facing, you know, this challenge of how to even get their disability recognized. You know, because that recognition is the basis of their entitlement to any right that they can claim from the state or society or, you know, so there are both sides to it, both sides. In fact, it's because of that huge problem that even the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act of 2016 had to issue this, make a clause there that the disability certificates will be, valid across the country. Earlier, even when you had a disability certificate, the problem was that, okay, so it will not be recognized if it is done in, say, one state. If you have obtained it in one state, it will not be recognized in, you know, other state or in the central body. So, you know, people had to fight. So, of course, you have one political perspective of the kind that I'm raising, and then you have also an equally valid, you know, perspective of a, you know, of a professional psychologist who has to, you know, see that people are identified, you know, for their disabilities.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Gupta. You really opened us to the fact that we all need to be open to multiple perspectives, and only then we can actually sort this issue of injustice. So thank you for that. We have one last question from Dr. Krishnaswamy. Dr. Krishnaswamy, you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Hello.
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah. My question was that so this reservation of physically for disabled people exists on paper, but it has very low implementation. No, it's I personally know of several cases, and one more recent case of a scholar with extremely good credentials who was working in Germany for many years. He applied to so many universities, and every time he did not get through, then people used to tell him privately, because our university cannot provide you the facilities you need. So it's a sort of and wherever it has been, I know in a place where it has been used more as a cover up rather than, you know, actually implementing it in letter and spirit. So how should this be addressed? I mean, this is there, the reservation has been there for so many years for the disabled, and now, as also pointed out, the percentages are there for different categories, but it's not getting implemented. So it's almost like the SCST Reservation Act. It is more implemented than the failure to implement it. Yeah, so have any panelists any suggestions on this?
Well, in my presentation, I did take up this issue, and, you know, we had to go to the court. And in fact, it was because of the court intervention that we could, in many, many cases, in fact, it was through the judicial intervention that we could secure, you know, reservation for personal. But what we did was something, I think, different from most of the other cases. What we did, we demanded from the court to make it mandatory for their university to follow the roster system and to put it in the public domain. And in fact, what happened, and this was Justice, forgetting his name, what he did is he not only ordered for the implementation of the roster system, because the roster system is common. Like, you have to adhere to it for everyone, you know, SC, ST, OBC, person with disabilities, as well as the general category, okay, and you have to put it in the public domain so that everybody knows that this is whose seat. And we questioned many advertisements where 100 seats were announced, but it was not said that out of this 100, whether, you know, which number and which subject is for which category. Only what they stated was that, okay, so 3% of this would go to your person with disability and 7% to so and so. So when we demanded for, you know, roster system, and we successfully also got it, you know, that it will be in the public domain so that everyone can see, you know, this resulted in the, I mean, whatever it has happened, whatever degree it happened for all, you know, reserve categories. And in fact, at that point of time, the court put a stay on all recruitments, you know, until, you know, the reservation for persons with disabilities has not been granted. Because we said that what is happening is that when you ask the employer, you know, for the reservation, they will say, abhi de diya hai? Nahi diya to, achha, then we will go and complain ki aapne to kaha tha 3% aapne diya nahi. So they'll say, no one was suitable, but next time we will give. Next time we will give, you know, so they never identified posts. So either one, either about this reservation thing, I would say that strict adherence to roster system, because that then also puts even the 50% of those general category seats under, you know, scrutiny. Strict adherence to roster system and demand for putting it on public domain. And that's what has been happening in Delhi University. It has given some benefit, of course, to all categories of reservation. So I think that should be on demand. And wherever this does not happen, I think the, you know, those administrations should be taken to the court. In fact, if you allow me, I just want to make a couple of things to in response to Prajwala's constructive suggestion that what concrete measures that one would suggest is, in fact, this is also in response to that question. Like, so far as the employment is concerned, with the implementation of the roster system, at least, I mean, in the public institutions, is, should be mandatory. Then the recommendation given by not a disability rights law, but by, you know, the Satcha committee, which is for maintaining a compulsory maintenance of a diversity register, diversity index in all public institutions. Now, here in this case, the public institutions means, you know, whether, you know, the state or the non-state, you know, I mean, in the prime diversity index, and not just about the number of people, but about their work, about their participation in their daily work. So the diversity index, then the introduction of, you know, the experiences of disability and, you know, the significant interventions of disability rights scholars in the mainstream syllabus. I think that's very, very important, apart from simply thinking of opening a disability study center, which is, which may be important, but it is very, very important to really make disability related experiences part of not only the written syllabus, but I think we really need an environment in which, you know, these issues are discussed in the class. And you know, of course, I think the debate between the inclusive and the special school is not settled, and I don't want to settle it here either. But in the mainstream institutions, if more and more exposure is given to persons who are quote unquote non-disabled, you know, to interact with persons with disabilities, to share things with them, to eat food with them, I think that will bring about a change. That's very, very important. And the last thing I want to say, of course, accessible infrastructure is the precondition. Without that, you cannot do this. The government of India and the state governments have been making a lot of promises, but all those promises are as on the paper, as is the whole idea of the Swachh Bharat. And I mean, I remember when this four-year degree program was launched in the Delhi University, and it initially made the study of science courses mandatory for every student, you know, in 1 year, I think it was. Of course, that course was scratched later on with the intervention of the central government. But what it did, you know, it bothered many of us. We raised a positive. We said that you first create accessible laboratories for persons with disabilities, you know, so that we don't have to, you know, we are not left behind. And then, unfortunately, contrary to the vision of the UNCRP, the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, what the Delhi University did, it only made a promise that we will, you know, augment our infrastructure. But what it did, following the line of the Persons with Disabilities Act of 1995, it gave a relaxation, a concession that, okay, so students with disabilities may not study science. And what is the result? Till date, we don't have a accessible lab, you know, where persons with disabilities can, you know, go and really do science. And I mean, some facilities may be there somehow, perhaps the orthopedically challenged students may manage, even though for them it's very difficult, but no visually impaired person for sure can think of doing science in India. And those of our friends who dare to do so, they had to go abroad. They couldn't practice it in India. You know, So I think, I mean, really making that, it should be a non-negotiable condition, I think. You know, it should be linked to our funding pattern, you know, when you approve something, whether it is inclusive or not. I think that's very, very essential. And yes, I do buy Professor Shastri's argument about the code of conduct. In fact, we were thinking once of even suggesting that when the administration writes that report, what is that called? That annual confidential report, I think, what is that? ACR, you know, which has a lot many columns. It should have a column about, you know, the behavior towards persons with disabilities. It's an issue that really at some point of time I was taking with, because nowadays I'm no longer so proactive in disability rights movement, but when we were, I mean, we really took up many of those issues, but they are still unresolved.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Gupta, for your views. And you've raised many, many questions. We all will have to think about those. I would like to make one last comment here. There's a PhD thesis by Amit Sharma at Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education, and in which he looked at science career aspirations of school kids. And he pointed out that the current systems create indirect barriers for dual learning and hence bar students with disabilities from careers in science. So Dr. Gupta had also pointed out, and it also came from Sonam's views, that you know, you deliberately give few marks or you deliberately design the questions in such a way that you know that student is not going to make it. And then you purposely just, you know, cut down the student's aspirations to become something. But that is not how it's going to work. We are never going to achieve that inclusion in the society. A lot of takeaways from this discussion today. I hope you all had a good time, and we really got to learn a lot. I myself was not aware about many things, but yeah, first of all, yes, policy, we all were speaking about it, and a lot needs to be done on policies. But before that, we can start by taking baby steps in that direction, like not labeling or providing early guidance, like what Dr. Mrityunjay suggested, to instill confidence among students. And we really need to start thinking of emotional support, or people needing, anyone can need this mental support at any moment. And like Dr. Gupta pointed out, that we all are differently abled. I completely agree with you, Dr. Gupta. And yes, that a lot of things that I have learned today from that. I'm sorry, there are some other questions coming, but we cannot take them because of the time issue. And with that, I would like to thank all our panelists who came today and discussed with us. It was quite an informative and an eye-opening discussion. In our next session, we would be covering class barriers and language barriers. So all of those who have joined with us, connected through Zoom or through Facebook Live, please join us. We will be sharing the details soon. I would like to also thank India March for Science Mumbai and the organizing team, Aniket, Professor Shastri, Divya Shankar and Manoj, for this nice session today that we had. Thank you all who connected us with Zoom and Facebook. And with that, I would like to say goodbye.